must have covered it very thoroughly.
It was really funny because we really didn't consult much with each other about what we were going to do, you know. So I didn't realize that Christopher and our stories would kind of intersect, you know, with, he was talking about the Writing Supreme fiasco that Igor Stravinsky wrote. And it just so happened that when the president, I was talking to Igor, evidently, the president said to pick up this conversation. The president said, "Now I understand that you, Mr. Stravinsky, were a friend of the Agudas. And I have just been told that rocks and tomatoes were grown to you in your youth. Since this is based on theater's briefing during dinner, when the story of the Writers' Spring premiere amazed the president and made him laugh out loud." And so the author here, Robert Kraft, explains to Stravinsky later that rocks and tomatoes is an American rendering. They are thrown at baseball umpires because he understood the statement literally. But anyway, so he said the speech is short, the American president's honoring a very creative artist, an event unprecedented in American history. It is moving. So anyway, that legend just circles all the time about everything that took place there. And here it was on the night being talked about it with Kennedy's.
If you want to see a great movie that recreates Paris just before the First World War and recreates brilliantly the premiere of Stravinsky's ballet, Le Sacre de Printemps, The Rite of Spring, it was made 2 or 3 years ago. It's called Igor and Coco. It's about Stravinsky's a brief little affair with Coco Chanel, the couturier, and the whole scene is so brilliantly recreated, including the first night. You have Diabolev, the producer and the impresario, clutching his chest and crossing himself all night. You have Nijinsky screaming in Russian at the dancers. The dancers don't know what they're doing, and in fact, in spite of a 40-piece orchestra, nobody can hear the music because everybody in the audience is screaming and throwing garbage at the stage. So. It's a terrific movie, Igor and Coco.
They need to make that into an opera, just the premiere.
Yeah, yeah. No money in it.
Yeah.
Well, does anyone have any?
I would be interested in your backgrounds and when you became so committed to classical music. When did you know that was for you?
Well, I think like most people in this business, I studied music when I was in school up until I got into, when I got to college, I took some voice. I never went into music to become a musician. I had studied music throughout school. But I always wanted to be in radio. And my dad was a television broadcaster when I was growing up. And so I thought, this is the life. This is the glamorous life. I'm going to go into broadcasting. I'm going to work in Chicago. I'm going to work in New York. I'm going to play rock and roll. I'm at a great time. And I found myself in the 80s needing a job. And I got an offer to come in and work at WOSU in the operations department. I had no idea what WOSU did. I'd never listened to them in my entire life. I walked in there and they had me getting things off the satellite and checking tapes and things. Tapes of those round things that they put music on or used to. I don't know if anybody has ever seen any of those. And one day they came in and said, and I was hearing the music as I was running the board, listening to things in the air. And one day the program director of the radio station came in to me and said, maybe you could read some news of the weather during some of the breaks. Would you come read an audition? I'd been in radio for almost 8 years before I got there. I thought, I'm auditioning to read a weather forecast. This is a new one for me. But I did, and she said, fine, so I did some breaks, and then it was, well, maybe you could do a little piece of film music here and there. Then one of our announcers went on vacation. Maybe you could do his shift for him while he's gone. And gave me all the nuts he gave. One thing led to another, and as I began to dig through the library and listen to things, I discovered this wealth of music that I had never dreamed was there. I didn't know anything about it beyond what I had been taught in school. And what I had sung when I sung in choirs and things, I didn't know. I couldn't have told you who Stravinsky was. I couldn't have told you who Rachmaninoff was. I didn't. Well, actually, I could have told you who Rachmaninoff was. My parents had one of his recordings, a recording of one of his pieces, not one of his recordings. And all of it started coming together. And as I began to dig through it, I would sit in my office for hours and listen to this music. But also that people would walk by and hear rock and roll and bluegrass and everything else coming out of my office. And our program director let me weave it together on the air. So you could play these things and put them in an interesting juxtaposition. And that kind of told me that it was all right to like it all. And it was all, you know, and you could make all of it interesting to people. And I got hooked. So I've been doing radio in this place for a long time now.
Yeah,
one of the
longest voices now on radio in Columbus.
Once that old guy Bob Connors retired, then
I've
been on the air on the radio in this market longer than anybody else. So there you go. Which just means that I stick around and I'm not willing to get kicked out.
created